गुड इवनिंग फ्रेंड्स, गुड आफ्टरनून फ्रेंड्स, हाउ आर यू ऑल गाइस? ओके, हेलो एवरीवन। सो वंस अगेन वी आर मीटिंग हियर फॉर द नेक्स्ट लेक्चर, राइट? आई होप ऑल ऑफ यू हैव वॉच द प्रीवियस लेक्चर। ऑल ऑफ यू हैव वॉच द प्रीवियस लेक्चर, दैट वॉज द यू ऑल नो, ओके। एंड वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट अप विद अ न्यू लेक्चर, वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट अप विद अ न्यू चैप्टर एक्चुअली, ओके, द इलेक्ट्रोस्टैटिक्स। एंड In today's class, we are going to study about the Coulomb's law. Okay? In today's class, we are going to study in detail about the Coulomb's law. Fine? And let's see as to what exactly are these, some of these terms like electrostatics. What do we mean by electrostatics? Okay? And what do we mean by the Coulomb's law? Where is this Coulomb's law valid? Where is the, what is the validity of the Coulomb's law? Some of you would have already heard of these things, right? So you would have already heard of what exactly is the Coulomb's law, what are the charges, okay? So some of the things, but starting with that, the first thing, that is the name of the chapter, that is electrostatics. Let's start off with the name. Let's try to understand what exactly is meant by electrostatics, right? See, in this one, the electro part, it means something related to charge, okay? The electro part means that it is related to charge, and statics, it means something is in rest, okay? You all know what is meant by rest. The body is in rest. Means, so what do we mean by electrostatics? That means the charges. We are going to study about the charges that are at rest, the charges that are in rest, okay? So this is the name of the chapter. This is about what we are going to study in this today's class, okay? So some of you would have already, all of you would have already heard of these, or would have performed these experiments, right? When you rub a comb in your dry hair, then, and you bring it close to pieces of bits of paper, then the bits of paper just get stuck to it. They will get attracted towards this particular comb, right? And similarly, you might have also heard of that, the lightning, okay? You would have seen the lightning on the sky when there is heavy rains and all of those things, right? In stormy weather, the clouds are actually moving very fast. They are rubbing against each other, right? And another very easy, very simple example was, you would have seen this figure, that when you rub two balloons, when you rub these two balloons, okay, then what happens? And you just hang them close to each other. They actually get repelled away. Okay, they get repelled away. When you try to bring them close to each other, they get repelled away. Okay, so what is actually happening over here is that you are actually producing some charge. There is some charge getting induced. That is the static charge that is getting induced in these types of things, right? Like the balloon or this particular comb or in the clouds. Okay, and whenever this charge just relaxes away, okay, whenever this charge just flows away, right, this static charge that got collected on this particular balloon, okay, or when it got collected in this particular clouds, when it just flows, then you will observe a spark, or when even if you touch this, if you try to touch this particular charge balloon, you might get a spark, you might observe a small spark in your hand, in your finger, right? So if you would have even observed these very small things. Right? So this is all related to the static charge. Means the charge which is actually getting collected in the body. It is not actually moving. Right? So this is related to the static charge. Okay? So another experiment was, some more experiments were performed in order to understand as to how many types of charges are there. Okay? So in case you have already studied in your chemistry about the electrons, protons and the neutrons, that's very good. I guess many of you would have already studied these things. Okay. So, experiments were performed using different substances by rubbing them with certain things. And then it was observed as to when the objects are getting attracted. Okay. It was observed that the two same objects, when they are rubbed, okay, when they are charged up and when the charge gets collected in them, then they always get repelled. That means the types of charge that we can understand easily, that the type of charge present in both the same objects, like the two balloons, it is of same type. Okay? And hence we also observe that they are getting repelled away. So we say that yes, they are having, so we say that actually what? That the like charges are repelling. Okay? And similarly, if you take a charged up or a rubbed glass rod and bring it close to a charged silk cloth, then it will get attracted. Okay? So this also showed that there is a property of the charges that the opposite charges are actually attracting each other. Right? So we say that there are actually two types of charges. One is, it is just a philosophy of saying that there are two types of charges. That is, one is a positive charge and the other one is the negative charge. It is just the philosophy. Do not think that a negative charge is a bad type of a charge. Okay? Negative charge is usually due to the electrons. It is always due to the electrons. And the positive charge is due to the presence of the protons. It is just our philosophy we are saying that proton is having a positive charge and electron is having a negative charge. This has just been coming out from the ages, so we are just following this thing. There is no such theory as to why it is always called a positive charge, and why can't we say what is the reason that electron is a negative charge. There is no such law behind this thing, okay? It is just that we are saying that yes, proton is having a positive charge, okay? Also, in your chemistry, you would have studied that a particular atom has three things, like neutron, electron and proton, okay? We have the third one, that is the neutron. Neutron is not having any charge, so it is not responsible for any electrostatics or any electrokinematics, okay? That is, no charge is present on this neutron. So it is not going to play any role in our studies, in our this entire thing, that whatever we are going to study in the electrostatics, okay? It is just the protons and the electrons. That is the positive charge and the negative charge. Okay? I hope you guys are getting this thing. It was just a convention to say that the glass rod is having a positive charge. Okay? When we rubbed a glass rod and a silk cloth, it was just our convention that we said that the glass rod, okay? The charge in the glass rod, we said that it is going to have a positive charge. Fine. It is just a convention. If we could have initially stated that, okay, glass rod is having a negative charge, then the humans would have followed that thing only, okay? Then proton would have been having a negative charge and electrons would be having a positive charge. But that is not the thing. We say that glass rod is having a positive charge. This is just a convention that we are following. And anything that gets attracted to this particular glass rod, that is charged glass rod, will be having a negative charge. Okay, we will say that it is having a negative charge. That is the reason that it is getting attracted. Fine. If any charged body is getting repelled away from this charged glass rod, then we will say that particular body is also having a positive charge. Okay. So this is a simple theory behind the types of charges. Okay, that is the protons and the electrons. You do not have to worry about what is the neutron. We will be dealing with neutrons in the nuclear physics that we will be studying in the later half of the year, okay? And this will be dealt also in your chemistry. About that, you can ask with your chemistry teachers, okay? So, once again, you can observe over here that how these charges are responsible for generating forces, okay? Electric charge giving rise to electric forces between charged particles. Right? I just now told you that if you bring a charged glass rod, okay, charged glass rod, we say that it is having a positive charge. If you bring it close to a rubber rod that is also charged, okay, that is also being rubbed up, and it is now having some charge. It is having some charge that is accumulated at one of its ends. Now, if you bring the two ends of these rods close to each other, what we find actually is that they attract each other, okay? So what was our convention? The convention was that the glass rod is going to have a positive charge. And our observation is that the rubber rod, this is a rubber rod, it gets attracted towards the glass rod. So we are going to say that it is having a negative charge, fine? Now another thing very important over here is that since it is getting attracted or it is getting repelled in this case, okay? It is getting attracted or it is getting repelled in this case and attracted in the first case. Okay, then what actually we say that there is some force present over here. Okay, these two rods are going to attract or repel each other with some force. That force is the electric force. Okay, that we will be studying as to what exactly, what are the other properties of this particular force. But the important thing that you have to understand over here is that these attraction or the repulsion is, there is some force associated with this attraction or the repulsion. Fine. I hope all of you are able to get this very easy, simple point, right? That there is some force in between the two bodies that have charge accumulated at them, that have a static charge accumulated. Okay. The static charge cannot easily flow. Okay, the static charge cannot easily flow. Okay. Okay, so now talking about the conductors and the insulators. Most of you would have been actually studying these things from your primary, from your late 2-3, from your past 2-3 years, right? What are the conductor, what are the insulators, you would have studied in your NCERT books. But still, let's have a look at them. The conductors and the insulators. Okay, the substances that allow electricity to pass through them easily are called conductors. Okay. Okay, fine. So, tell me whether I'll be going to ask you a question. Okay. Your options are yes or no. And my question is, you have to tell me, since I expect that most of you would be already studying about this conductors. My question is, tell me whether the non-metals in general, tell me whether the non-metals are the conductors or not. Give me your answers in the poll. Yes, friends, tell me. Tell me whether the non-conductors, tell me about the non-conductors, are they, I'll just write it down over here. I'm asking about the non-metals. Non-metals, are they conductors or not? Okay, so most of you are saying that non-metals are, you observe over here, that non-metals. Just one wrong answer. So, okay. So, friends, non-metals are, yes, they are not the conductors. Okay. They are not the conductors. They are the insulators in general. Okay. We have the metals as the conductors. Fine. So, whatever in general you will find the metals, they will be known as the conductors. They can easily allow the flow of the electrons. Okay. You know what is electricity? Electricity is the flow of electrons. Okay. Whenever you are able to have a certain object where the electrons can easily flow, we say that is a conductor, or it allows the electricity to pass through them. Okay. Why is it so? Why is it so that they allow the electrons to flow? Whereas talking about the insulators, have a look at the insulators. These are the substances that do not allow electricity to pass through them easily. Okay. So you can all say that yes, the non-metals, they are the insulators, right? The non-metals are the insulators. Actually, what is happening over here is that the conductors have free electrons, okay? They have large number of free electrons, and hence they can easily allow the electrons to just flow through their material, okay? Whereas the insulators, they do not allow the, they do not have any such large number of free electrons, right? Hence, they do not allow the easy flow of the electrons, and hence no electricity. Fine. The electrons are not, they have the electrons in the insulators are bounded very tightly. You can just understand it in this manner, that the electrons are bounded very tightly, whereas they are loosely packed in the conductors. You will be studying actually about as to how, what is the electronic configuration of the different metals and the non-metals. There you will be actually understanding as to how the metals are actually having they have the free electrons in the outer shell, whereas the non-metals do not have any such free electrons in their outer shell. The electrons that are present in the non-metals, they are tightly bound, okay? Hence, they cannot escape out from their atom. Whereas in the conductors or in the metals, the electrons that are present in the outer shell, they can easily escape out from these metals. from these atoms, okay, and hence they can allow, they can be easily flown, and hence they allow the electricity to pass through them, okay. So this is about the electricity and this is about the conductors and the insulators, okay. So next very important thing, one of the very common examples that you might have observed in the, in case somebody has been not expect somebody to go into the operating room, operation room, okay, but to visit somewhere to someone, in case somebody has gone to a hospital to visit someone, okay, you might have observed, okay, that the people working in the hospitals wear special conducting shoes while working under oxygen in an operating room, okay. The first thing that you have to understand as to why, just about oxygen, what is the use of this oxygen. See, oxygen is a substance that is required for combustion of a particular object, okay. If you have to burn anything, if you have to generate a spark, if you want to generate fire, if you want to burn anything, then you need oxygen, okay. Oxygen is a must. Also, one more important property of the oxygen is that it is the air, it is the thing that we breathe in, okay. So the patients require oxygen, fine. So in the operating room, it is an oxygen rich environment, okay. The environment is actually oxygen rich, so that the patient can easily breathe in. Therefore, that particular arena is actually rich in oxygen, fine. Next important thing is that the people working in the hospitals, okay, in that particular area where it is oxygen rich, they are continuously moving, okay. They are continuously moving with, they are wearing the rubber shoes, okay. They are wearing the shoes and they are continuously moving on that particular area, okay. Now, when they are continuously moving, I hope all of you can actually understand that their shoes are continuously rubbing with the ground or with the floor, okay. Their shoes are continuously going to rub against the floor or with the ground, okay. So when their shoes or their whatever they are wearing, okay, it is actually made up of rubber, okay, the shoes, they are made up of rubber or any substance. When it is getting rubbed up, okay, what is going to happen? And imagine this thing. What is going to happen? Just imagine as to what can happen. Whenever you rub any two things, okay, whenever, suppose you are rubbing your hand, heat is getting generated. Okay, so similarly, when you are walking on the floor and continuously you are moving here and there with your shoes, then what is going to happen? Their shoes are getting rubbed and heat is going to generate. And since it is an oxygen rich environment, it may happen that a spark gets generated. And if a spark gets generated, then then the things might catch fire. Okay, and the objects around that particular area might catch fire, and that will be a disastrous thing, okay. So this is the reason as to why we say that the people who are working near those hospitals, they should be wearing not the shoes that are made up of insulating type of material. They should be wearing the shoes that are made up of the material that is like conductors, that can easily allow, okay. See, when they are rubbing, when the shoes are getting rubbed, the charge gets accumulated in their shoes. Okay. And when it gets accumulated, when you are just moving here and there, it gets accumulated and the spark may get ignited. Okay. But if you are wearing the conducting shoes, what can happen? If you are wearing the conducting shoes, no spark will get accumulated at your shoe. And the spark will simply, what will happen to the spark? Earthing, that means that whatever the charge that was getting collected on the shoe, it will simply drain out to the earth. I hope all of you know what is earthing. Okay, I'll just explain you over here as to what exactly is earthing, in case anybody is unaware of it. What I'm speaking is earthing. Okay, you might have actually observed that the very tall buildings, okay, suppose that this is a very tall building. Okay, what is present at the top of the building? A metallic conductor, okay, that is going all through the building, okay. this antenna that you observe on the roof of the building, it is not only of this much length, okay, it is of the entire building's length, okay, that is coming out of the roof of the building, right? What is, why is it so? You might have observed, you might have studied as the, what is the reason for this particular earthing, what is the reason for this particular metallic material, metallic rod that is present at the roof of the tall buildings, that is to whatever the light, due to the lightning that occurs on the sky, okay, the charge that simply flows out on the building, okay, it damages the building, but we put this particular, this thing, antenna metallic pole, okay, what you want to call it, okay, we put it so that the charge, whatever is getting flowing, that is flowing in the air, it simply easily drains down to the earth. This is the earth. It easily drains down to the earth and it does not even reaches the building. Okay? It does not even reaches the other parts of the building. It simply just reaches the earth without even hampering the building. So this is earthing. Okay? When we are draining out the charge from the body to the earth, without hampering the body. This is known as earthing. So this is exactly what is happening on these particular shoes, what the people are wearing in the, on these hospitals areas. Okay. I hope all of you are able to understand why the people wear conducting shoes, not just the usual shoes, right? Okay. So that the charge does not get accumulated and it drains out on the earth. Fine. So let's move ahead with the today's class. Okay. The next is the electrification. Okay. The next is the electrification. That is, a body can be electrified through the following methods. That is, how can you induce charge on a particular body? How can you induce charge on a, on this particular body? Just now I gave you an example that if you wear normal shoes on that particular hospital area that is oxygen rich, what will happen? The charge will get accumulated on your shoes. That was due to the rubbing of the shoes. That was due to the rubbing of the shoe, okay? So there are other methods also. There are different other methods also like induction and conduction. I'll just, you all know what is about some more, you can give more examples about the rubbing, right? Like when you are just rubbing a comb on your dry hair, then also the charge gets accumulated on the, on your comb, right? Or when you are rubbing the two balloons, then also the charge gets accumulated. So this, these are the examples through which you can understand as to how a body can be electrified by charging, charging by rubbing. Okay, it can be, how it can be electrified by rubbing. Fine. Next is the induction. Next is the induction. I am going to give you an example. Try to understand it. Suppose that this is a pith ball. Okay. Suppose that this is a pith ball. Pith ball is having some charge on it. Pith ball is having a large amount of charge on it. Let's say it is having a large amount of positive charge on it. Fine. Now what I am going to do is I am going to place another particular body over here. Okay. Now what I am going to do is, what I want actually is, I want that the charge should be induced from this body, from this pith ball. This is the pith ball. It is having a large amount of charge. Let's say that it is having a large amount of positive charge. Okay. Suppose I want some charge from this pith ball to get transferred to this particular body. Okay. How am I going to do it? I'm going to connect it with some material, with some rod. You can say I'm going to connect it, these two bodies with some rod. Now my question is, what it should be? Should it be a conductor or an insulator? Okay. This is my question. If I want that the charge to be passed from the pith ball to this particular body, what should be the material of, what should be the, my rod? Should it be a conductor or a insulator? Give me your answers. I hope you are able to understand the question, right? Very good. You can all observe that all of you are actually giving the correct answer. Right, 100% correct answer. All of you should be taking part in the poll. Okay, I hope all of you are able to take part in the poll. Should be able to give the answers. Okay, yes. So the rod should be a conductor. So this is known as charging by induction. Okay. this is known as what? Actually, this is known as charging by conduction. Okay, this is known as charging by conduction, not charging by induction. Okay, we are going to study charging by induction later on after the slides. Okay, so you know the example of the charging by rubbing, and just now that I gave you the example of the spith ball. This was for the charging by conduction. That is, we are actually using this rod as a conducting material. Okay, you are using this rod as a conducting material. Okay, so this is known as charging by conduction. This one example. Okay, we have this pith ball. Pith ball is, you might have also observed in your some of the Hollywood movies or in your English soaps, that whenever a person, you might have seen that Mr. Bean's movie where he is keeping a hand on a particular spear. Okay, then the hairs of the person just get stand up. Okay, they get erected. The hairs of the person, the head hair. Okay, so that is the thing that happens when you touch a pith ball. Okay, so that is because your body is actually a good conductor. Your body is a conductor. Okay, so the charge actually flows through your body. Fine. So that is what happens in the charging by conduction. That is actually what is happening while there is the earthing. Okay. So this is about the charging by conduction. Now we are going to see what is charging by induction. Now we are going to see the charging by induction process. Okay. So suppose you have this particular body, that is this spherical body. Okay, you have this spherical body. See, one more important thing is that we cannot create charge. We cannot create or destroy charge. Just like mass. Okay, we cannot create or destroy mass. Okay. Just like we cannot create or destroy energy. Okay, energy can only be transferred from one form to another. Similarly, we cannot create or destroy charge. Okay, charge remains conserved. We will be studying about these properties of the charge also. But as of now, try to understand, for an isolated system, okay, for an isolated system, suppose that you have this particular ball, this ball, okay. If it is not going to interact with any body, any surrounding body, then the total amount of charge that is present on this body is going to remain same. Okay, although it may happen that a negative charge is getting accumulated at one end and the positive charge is getting accumulated at the other end, right? But the net charge on this body is going to remain the same if it is not interacting with this surrounding. If it is not physically interacting with its surrounding, right, means that is, there is no physical interaction, that is, no other body is touching this body. Okay, if no other body is touching this body, then the net charge is going to remain constant. Fine. So let's see what is the, how can we do the charging by induction. In the, we can just show it over here in the four easy steps. In the step one, suppose you have this glass rod. Okay, you know that you can observe over here that this rod is having a positive charge. Okay, suppose that this rod is having some positive charge, it is a glass rod. Okay, then what is going to happen is, you know that the positive charge is going to attract the negative charge. So there are some electrons on this particular ball, as well as there are some protons on this particular ball. The electrons are having the negative charge, fine. So you know that the electrons can easily flow, and the electrons will come towards this positive charge. The electrons will come towards this positive charged rod at the end, that where we are placing this particular rod, fine. Later on, what is going to happen is that the positive charge will definitely, it is going to get repelled. Okay, the positive charge on the ball will get repelled from this particular rod, so it will go to the other extreme end, fine. Now what I am going to do is, I am going to earth it. This is the symbol of earthing. That is, I am going to connect this particular end of the ball with a conducting wire, and the other end of the conducting wire will be in the earth. Okay, I'll place it on the earth. So that this positive charge that is present over here will simply move out. It will just flow out through this particular wire, through this particular conductor, and it will go to the earth. Okay, earth is a big reservoir of the charge. Okay, so this particular positive charge will just drain out from this body and it will go to the earth. Now the net charge that is present on this ball is only this negative charge. It is only this negative charge, fine. please observe over here that we do not bring this particular rod in contact, or we do not touch this particular rod with this ball. It is placed at some distance. It is placed at some small distance. Okay, we make sure that there is some distance in between these two things. Fine. So we have the now we have what we have negative charge in this particular ball. Okay. Then we just take away our glass rod. Then we just take away this glass rod, and this ball is again left out with the negative charge only. Okay, you can observe over here that now the negative charge will get dispersed away equally. Okay, it will easily get dispersed away in the entire body. Okay, so now this body is going to have negative charge because we have drained out the positive charge, and now it is going to have only the negative charge. So this is how we can induce the charge. Okay, this is how we are inducing the charge on a particular body by actually removing out some type of a charge. That is the positive charge in this case. Okay, so this is about charging by induction. Fine, we have already seen the three types of methods, that is charging by rubbing, charging by induction, and this one is the charging by conduction. Okay, so some of the properties of the charge. Before describing these properties, tell me whether this charge. You all know what is a scalar and a vector quantity. Okay. Tell me whether charge is a scalar quantity or a vector quantity. You have your options. You know that charge is some quantity, right? So tell me whether this charge is a scalar quantity or a vector quantity. Please be careful while answering. Okay. You need to have some logic. I want all of you to answer, okay? Do not worry even if you are giving me the wrong answers. But try to think, okay? Not just blindly give me any answer. Do not just blindly give me the answers. Okay. So you can observe over here that most of you are saying that it is the scalar quantity. Okay? Charge is a scalar quantity. I'll tell you how. I actually relate it with mass. See, any body that you have over here, suppose I have a marker over here. Okay, suppose I am having a marker over here. Okay, it is having some mass. It is definitely going to have some mass. And this mass is going to be a positive thing. Okay, we never say that a body has a negative mass. There is no such thing, right? A body, there is nothing such concept that something is having negative mass. Okay, mass is always a positive quantity. But since see, observe over here that a body can have charge just as it has mass. Mass is something that we weigh. Okay, charge is nothing that we can weigh, but it is having some positive charge as well as some negative charge in it. The net charge on this body is zero. Okay, because it is having some positive and it is having some negative, so the net becomes zero. Fine. The point over here is that the charge is of two types. Mass is not of two types. Mass is just mass. Okay, mass, we cannot say that it is a negative mass or a positive mass, but we have a charge just like mass of a body, and this charge can either be positive or negative. Okay, this is the only thing. Okay, it can either be positive or negative. So for those of you who are thinking that a charge can be positive as well as negative, and hence it becomes a vector, that is not the correct thing. Okay, we do not say that I have a charge of something in this direction. We do not require a direction to define the charge on a body. Okay, we do not require any direction to define the charge on a body. Fine, we just need the magnitude. Okay, magnitude, that means just the magnitude as well as the sign, whether it is the positive charge or the negative charge. That is the sense of the charge, not the direction of the charge. Okay, whether it is a negative charge or a positive charge. It does not, positive and negative charge does not mean that it is in the positive x-axis or it is in the negative x-axis. No, it does not mean something like that. Okay, do not get confused with this thing. Fine. So charge is a scalar quantity. It is not a vector quantity. Okay. So let's now have a look at some of these properties of the charge, that is the additivity of the charge. Let's have a look at the first one. See, suppose you have any body, any lump of a body, okay, any lump that you have. So for an isolated system, what do you understand by the isolated system? Isolated system, suppose this is what do we, so when I say that this is an isolated system, then actually what I mean is that it is not going to interact physically with any of this surrounding. Okay, that means I'm not going to touch, no other external body is going to touch this body. Okay, then it becomes an isolated system. Fine. Suppose in space, moon is an isolated system. Okay, why? Because no other planet or no other star is going to physically touch the moon. Okay, so this is a isolated system. Now, for an isolated system, what we have is the additivity of the charge. That is the net charge. If I say that in the entire Earth or in the entire moon, if I say that there is some, at some places there is some charge Q1. Okay, suppose that in New Delhi some charge is Q1. Okay, in Qatar some charge is Q6. Okay, similarly in UAE in some charges Q2. Okay, in Iran some charges Q3, in USA some charges Q4, in Australia some charges Q5, right? So when you are entirely talking about the isolated system, that is the Earth in this case, right? Then the net charge on this particular Earth is going to remain constant. And what we do is that we are going to add up this charge in order to get the net charge. That is Q is equal. So Q is the net charge on this particular body or on this isolated system, that is the Earth. How are you going to add it up? We are going to add it up in this manner. That is Q is equals to Q1 plus Q2 plus Q3 plus Q4 plus Q5 plus Q6. We are going to add them up algebraically. Okay, we are going to add them up algebraically. Okay, that is, we are going to use their signs as well. Okay, if I say that one of the charge is a negative charge, then we are going to use that negative sign. We are going to make use of that negative sign while adding the charges. Okay, I'll be taking some examples. Okay, and I just tell you as to what exactly is the unit of charge. That is the Coulomb. So we'll be taking up that part also. Okay, so this is the additivity of the charges. We have to add the individual charges, the entire charges on the entire body, entire mass of the entire thing, entire object that we are choosing, in order to get the net charge on that particular body. Okay, I just now told you that regarding the conservation of the charge. Once again, you can observe over here that the total charge of an isolated system always remains constant. Fine. That means the net charge on Earth, in the previous case it was Q. Okay, so the Earth is not going to interact with anybody else. So the net charge on the Earth is Q. Okay, it's Q, and it is going to remain constant forever. This is not going to change. Okay, this charge, that is the net charge, the total charge on the Earth, it is not going to change. This is the conservation of charges. Okay, just as the mass of a body is not going to change. Okay, mass energy, you can just, if some of you must be aware of that famous Einstein's equation, that E is equal to mc square, where energy and mass can be easily transferred. Then you can understand it in this manner, that the energy mass system, energy mass of a, mass energy of a body cannot be changed. Similarly, the net charge on the body cannot be changed. Okay, it always remains constant. Fine. So this was the second property of the charges. So let's now try to solve this question. All of you just try to solve this question. Okay, and read it out, solve it very carefully. It is just based on the things that I just taught you. Okay, we just discussed. I will be giving you the options, give me your answers. I'm giving you four options, okay? Okay, so this is not B, this is C. Okay, so these are your options. The last one is 2. Okay. So these are your options, and please try to give me the answers. You have two identical metal spheres P and Q that are charged, and a sphere P has a net charge of 8Q. Okay, and a sphere Q has a net charge of minus 4Q. Then if we connect the spheres through a wire and disconnect them, then what will be the net charge on each sphere? So suppose we have this P and this is the sphere number Q. This is P and this is Q. So I'll be posting the poll also so that you can give me answers. Okay. So give me your answers in the poll. Okay, so most of you, let's share the results. Many of you, most of you are able to understand this thing, right? That the correct answer is majority is okay. Do not make any mistakes, okay? Do not make any mistakes while giving the answers. Okay, let's end the poll. Observe the correct the solution of this question. Okay, observe the solution of this question. So you have this you have these spheres P and Q. They have the charges what? 8Q and minus 4Q. Now when I connect them with a conducting wire, when I connect them with a wire, okay. So this one was having 8Q and this is having minus of 4Q. Fine. Now can I say that the net charge on this system, can use this color. Now my system is this thing, the one in the green part. This is my entire system. Try to understand as to how I am taking this as a system, the one in the green part, the entire two spheres as well as the wire. The complete thing I am taking is the system. What is the net? Try to calculate the net charge on the system. It is the net charge on the system is 8q minus 4q, or if you want it, I can add it up in this one, 8q plus minus of 4q. Okay, so this becomes how much? 4q. Now it is mentioned over here that the two spheres are identical. Okay, that means the two spheres are identical, two metallic spheres are identical, and they are metallic. Okay, they are also metallic. So this 4q will get equally distributed in the two spheres. This 4q will get equally distributed in the two spheres. So your correct answer is going to be 2q. Okay, it is not going to be 4q or minus 4q or minus 2q. Okay, I hope all of you agree with this solution, that is 2q. 2q will be the net charge on each sphere. That is the answer. Fine. So let's now have a look at the units of the units and what is meant by quantization of the charges. Okay, the third property of the charges. See, all observable charges are always some integral multiples of the elementary charge E. That is 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 coulombs. See, actually this value, it is the value of the charge. See, it is a positive value over here, right? And it is mentioned that it is that all observable charges are integral multiples of this particular value. Now, integrals are negative, positive also, right? Negative also, positive also, either, and also it is zero. Okay? So these are the integrals. Integrals means 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Not 1.5, 2.2 or 3.3. No, these are not the integrals. The integrals are minus 10, minus 9, minus 1, 0, 1, 2. So these are the integers, right? These are the integers. So all the observable charges that you will be coming across are the integral multiples of this thing. Okay, I hope all of you are getting this thing. That is Q is equal to NE, where N is the integer. Okay, so this is the thing. And actually, what I was going to tell you is that what exactly is this 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 coulombs? Coulombs is the SI unit of charge. okay, you can just note it down that this is also one of the fundamental units, right? That SI unit of charge is coulombs. We are using the letter C over here for representing the charge on the coulomb, for representing the coulombs, okay? This 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 coulombs, if you are taking the positive value, this is equal to the charge on one proton, okay? And similarly, if you are taking the value that is minus of 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 coulombs, okay? Then this is the charge on one electron. Okay? The negative value, right? Observe over here, what is the charge on one proton? It is 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 coulombs. And what is the charge on one electron? It is 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 coulombs. Just a negative sign has been mentioned over there, right? Minus one. Okay. So does it mean that just observe this question now, and you'll have to give me the answer. Okay. You have to give me the answer in the whiteboard. I am mentioning the options. Does this mean that the proton is having this much more amount of charge? I'll write it down over here. 3.2 into 10 to the power minus 19 coulombs. Does it mean that the proton is having 3.2 into 10 to the power minus 19 coulomb of charge more than the electron? Listen to the question, okay? And then respond in the poll. My question is, you know that what is the value, what is the charge present in the electron and the proton? My question is, does it mean that the charge on the proton is 3.2 into 10 to the power minus 19 coulombs more than the electron? Just the 4 volts, 5 volts. What about the rest of you? You can observe your answers. Okay, yes. So, most of you are correct, right? Most of you are correct. It does not mean that the charge on the proton is 3.2 into 10 to the power minus 19 coulombs more than the electron. Okay? It simply means that it is of the opposite side. It is of the opposite sense. Okay? That is, the charge on the electron is of the opposite sense that of the proton. Okay? Although, if you just bring the electron and if you just have an electron and a proton in a system, then the net charge will definitely become zero. Okay, the net charge will definitely become zero because you are going to add them up. Okay, fine. So this was about the quantization of the charges. Okay, next one is the Coulomb's law. This is a very important one. What is meant by a Coulomb's law? Okay, you can just have a quick few seconds break in order to, in case, see friends, I already told you that whenever you are having any doubts, any queries, please list them down in the notebooks, whatever you are having, whatever you are carrying during the classes, okay? So, and then later post it on in the ask and answer forum that you are made available of, okay? So, we have this Coulomb's law. Now, try to understand it very carefully. What is exactly meant by Coulomb's law? Where is it exactly, where is it actually valid? And some of the other important points related to it, okay? Coulomb's law tells about the force that is acting in between the two charges due to the interaction of the two charges. Okay, you have the two charges, let's say it is you have two charges Q1 and Q2, and R is the distance between them. Okay, then the force that is going to act, the force of attraction, over here it is the force of attraction or repulsion. I do not know whether it is the force of attraction or repulsion. Okay, but the force that is going to act, that is going to be present in between these two charges, that is proportional to the product of these two charges and inversely proportional to the square of the distance between the two charges. This is a very important thing. This one. You'll have to remember this formula. Okay? The force that is existing between the two charges is proportional to their product and inversely proportional to the square of the distance between them. This is the Coulomb's law. Fine? Now, when you remove this proportionality sign, okay, when you remove this proportionality sign, what you actually get is F is equals to K Q1 Q2 upon R square. This K is the proportionality constant. Okay? And this K is also equal to 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught. Fine? This K is also known as K is the proportionality constant. It is also represented, written in this form. That is, K is equal to 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught. Okay? Observe over here some of the very important things. What exactly is this epsilon naught? Epsilon naught is the absolute, I'm writing down over here, absolute permittivity. You'll have to remember these things. Because there are a large number of, there will be 3-4 more terms like this epsilon naught. Okay? Absolute permittivity of free space. Absolute permittivity of free space. Okay? And the value of epsilon naught. The numerical value of epsilon naught is 8.85. You'll have to note down this value. That is 8.854 multiplied by 10 to the power minus 12. And its unit is Coulomb square Newton inverse meter minus 2. Okay? This is the value of epsilon naught. Fine? Also, another important data that we'll have to remember, these are all the experimental things. The value, what is the value of epsilon naught or what is the value of K? Okay? You'll also have to remember the value of K. What exactly is the value of K or what is the value of 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught? It is this thing that I'm going to write down. That is 9 into 10 to the power 9 multiplied by 10 to the power 9 Newton meter square Coulomb minus 2. Okay? This is the value of K. You can obtain the value, you can just put the value of epsilon naught, this one, you can just put this 8.854 into 10 to the power minus 12 in this formula and you will get the value of K as 9 into 10 to the power 9 Newton square Coulomb minus 2. Okay? The important relationship has been shown in the green, okay, just in the red colored box, and you have to put the constant over here. That is the K, that is the value, 9 into 10 to the power 9. All these values that I have written are in the SI units, okay? So, another very important thing is that, what is the validity of the Coulomb's law? Observe over in this question now. Is Coulomb's law valid for all types of charged objects? Okay, yes, it is valid for whether it is a negatively charged or a positively charged object, right? But there are few things that the body should be a point charge. Okay, the body should be a point sized body. Okay, you can observe in this figure that the body, the Q1 and Q2, they are point sized bodies. Okay, Q1 and Q2 are the point sized body. They should not be enlarged body. Okay, they should be point sized body. Just like the stars, you know that to us, the stars appear like the point sized bodies, but actually they are not the point sized bodies. But to us, what it appears that the stars are the point sized bodies. They are not the enlarged bodies. Okay? Similarly, the Coulomb's law is valid only for point sized bodies. Not for enlarged bodies. Only for point sized bodies. Another very important thing is that the charge should not be moving. We are studying the electrostatics. That is, the charge on the body should be stationary, should be at rest. Okay? The charge should not be moving. Right? So, the whatever is the point that you are considering, the whatever the point sized body that you are considering is, that body, for that particular body, the charge on that body should not be moving. It should be stationary. This is the second condition for the validity of the Coulomb's law, where you can apply the Coulomb's law. That is this equation. That is F is equal to K Q1 Q2 upon R square. Okay. But friends, you know, okay, you can just solve this question now. Later on, we'll be coming up to the vector form of that particular force. So guys, just solve this question. Let's see if you can solve this particular question. You just read it out. You just have to equate the forces. I hope all of you know what is the gravitational forces. And just now what you have studied is the electrostatic force. Okay. Electrostatic force was the force that was mentioned in the Coulomb's law. That is F. Fine, so just read out the question. In order to cancel the gravitational forces between the Earth and the Moon, they are given equal charges. Now, what should be the magnitude of these charges? We want to know the magnitude of these charges. The given data is mass of the Earth, mass of the Moon, and the distance between Earth and the Moon, and the gravitational constant. Assume that Earth and Moon are like point-sized bodies, and the distance between them is 384.00 kilometers. Okay. Yes. So just you have to equate the two forces. Fine. You know that the gravitational force is always an attractive force. It is never a repulsive force. But your this electrostatic force can either be attractive or repulsive. Fine. So tell me, my first question to you is, tell me whether the two forces on the charges that you will be going to put on the Earth and the Moon, whether they are going to be of same sign or they are going to be of opposite sign. Okay. So this is the question. First of all, tell me this thing. Whether the two charges that you are going to place on that Earth and the Moon, are they going to be of the same sign? Either they will be positive or negative, or they are going to be of negative, or they are going to be of opposite signs, like positive and negative. Okay. So the equal votes for approximately equal votes. 5-6. Okay. Observe over here, friends, that the gravitational force is always the electrostatic force. It is always a attractive force. Okay. Gravitational force is always a attractive force. So in order to cancel out that force, in order to cancel the gravitational force, what we need is a force that is repulsive in nature. That is the electrostatic force. We need an electrostatic force that says that yes, I have to be repulsive in nature. So how is it possible? It is possible only if I place the same types of charges on the Earth and the Moon. Okay, you know that the same charges repel each other, right? Means if you want to put positive charges, then the positive charge should be placed on both of them, the Earth as well as on the Moon. If you are placing negative charge, then it should be on both of them, that is the Earth and the Moon. Okay, so now solve the question. So you can just, I hope all of you remember the formula of the gravitational force between the two bodies of mass, if their masses and their distances are given. Right, so I'll just write it down. All of you can just check it out. This is the force due to gravity, force due to the gravitational effect, okay. The gravitational constant value is given, known to you. So capital M is the mass of the Earth and small m is the mass of the moon, okay. And the distance between them is d square. Sorry, the distance between them is d, in the formula it becomes d square. Fine. And now the electrostatic force. If I have to write the electrostatic force, you have the constant that is K and Q. Okay, the two forces on the two bodies are going to be equal, right? Just as we had seen in the previous example. And the distance between them is once again d, so it's d square over here. So you just have to equate them. Fine. When you just equate them, then you will be able to get the answer. That is, you will find the relationship that is Q square is actually equal to G M M upon K. Fine. And then you can just put the values. Simply put the values, and then you can get the answer. Just do the under root. What you are going to do is under root of this thing. This will give you the answer. Your answer. Fine. D square will get cancelled from both the sides, and what you will get is this as the answer. Just put the values and then you will get the answer. I hope all of you can do this thing. This is a very easy part. Fine. So let's now discuss the force, okay? The Coulomb's law in the vector form. Let's now discuss the Coulomb's law, how we can represent this Coulomb's law, the force that was this one. And we just not derived, that is vector F. Okay, we know that the force is a vector. We just not, whatever we discussed was the magnitude of that force. But if we have to find the direction as well, if you have to represent it in complete form, magnitude as well as its direction in a complete vector form, then that thing we are going to observe over here now. Okay, see, we have this F12 and F21. These are the two forces. These are the two forces that are acting on the two different charges, Q1 and Q2. Okay. Observe over here that these two forces, these two F12 and F21, I can say that they are going to be, what I can say, according to the Newton's law, I can say that they are going to be equal in magnitude and opposite in direction. Okay. That is, I can say that F12 is equal to minus of F21. But before that, we'll have to understand actually what exactly is this F12. Observe over here that we all know that the two charges are going to exert, they are going to exert some force on each of them. Means Q1 is going to exert some force on Q2 and Q2 is going to exert some force on Q1. The electrostatic forces, right? We are not considering the gravitational forces now, so forget about it, right? So F12 is the force on one due to two. It is the force on the charge Q1 due to this charge Q2, F12. I'll just write it down over here. All of you just write it down what exactly is meant by F12. It is the force on Q1 due to Q2. Okay. And similarly, what I have is F21. All of you just note this thing very carefully. What exactly is F12 and what is exactly is F21. This is the force on Q2 due to Q1. Okay. These are the two notations you will have to understand over here. Fine. Now, we had already discussed about the position vector of the two bodies, of the two points in the previous class. I hope all of you remember it. The position vectors of the two points of any particular body or of any particular point. Okay. We are writing it as vector R. Okay. So if I have to write down what is the position vector of the point 1 with respect to vector 2, what is the position vector of the point 1 with respect to 2? You have to understand that thing carefully now. Okay. Actually, that is used to get the direction of the vector. Okay. That is used to get the direction of the force of these two different forces. Okay. We are going to understand that thing also now. Right. So, actually the vector R12. Okay. Just all of you also would be remembering that how to get a unit vector. How to get a unit vector. This is a unit vector R12, okay? That is pointing towards the 2, okay? If you just have a look at not the R vector, R, just the unit vector, just have a look at the original vector, that is vector r12. This vector means that it is a position vector or just a displacement, that is a distance vector, okay, displacement vector you can call it, or the position vector from the vector 1 to 2, okay, the position vector that you can just subtract it in this manner, that is the position vector of the point 1 minus position vector of point 2. What you will obtain is 1 minus 2, that is in this direction, okay. So what we have actually, let's not just talk about this force, let's not just talk about the force F21, okay, how to get the direction of this force F21, how we are going to represent it, observe it very carefully now. F21 is the force in this direction, okay. So how we are going to write it as KQQ, this is V, okay, so these are the charges Q1 and Q2, and we know that the distance between them is modulus of r. I can just write it as r, okay, or this r can be written as r12. This is the square of the distance between the two charges. Now how to represent the direction? The direction is from 1 towards the 2. The what is the direction of the force F21? That is the force of Q2 due to force of Q2, force on Q2, okay, it should be force on Q2. This one should be force on Q2 due to Q1. What it is? It is in this rightwards direction. Try to understand this point now. How to understand it very in the basic form. Okay. So this is the direction. Now how can I get this direction? How to write the direction now? We are going to make use of this vector. The unit vector. What is the unit vector or the position vector with respect to 2? Okay. Of the 1. Right, so how we are going to write it as? This is r12. That is 1 minus 2. This is 1 minus 2. Okay. And if I have to write down the position vector, if I have to write down the direction, okay, can I use the unit vector? We had discussed in the previous class that unit vectors are basically used to get the directions. They are used to denote the direction. So in order to denote the direction of this force vector, I am going to use my unit vector, that is unit vector r12. And what it is? I hope all of you remember that formula. Okay. I'll just write it down in the whiteboard first of all, so that you can just recall that A cap is equal to this thing, right? So similarly, what I can do is r12 cap is equal to vector r12 divided by modulus of vector r12. Okay, this is the thing that I'm going to do in this case in order to get the direction of the force vector F21. Okay, so in order to get the direction, what I'm going to do is this thing. I'm going to divide the vector with its magnitude, so it becomes vector r divided by once again the modulus of vector r12. Okay, what is it written over here? Observe it very carefully. It is written vector r12. It is written vector r12, this one, and in the denominator I have written the modulus of vector r12. Okay, so this thing I am writing over here, it is the unit vector. It is, I am trying to denote the direction of this vector force F21. Okay. So when I just combine these two denominator parts, what I am going to obtain is, I'm just writing down over here. I'm going to write it down over here. Okay. In the whiteboard. What I just wrote down over there was F21. The vector F21 is actually equal to KQ1 Q2 and r12, okay, square. This was the magnitude part, right? And for the direction I was writing vector r12. Okay, this was about the for the vector, and this one was actually equal to what? Vector r12 divided by magnitude of vector r12. Fine. So this is, or you can say that this is the, you can either use vector unit vector r12 or you can use this form. Both of them are correct, right? This is the vector representation of the forces, that is the electrostatic forces. Okay. Similarly, what I can say is the, similarly I can actually represent the other force, that is the vector F12. I am going to write it down, please note it down very carefully. That is vector F12 is equal to K Q1 Q2 divided by vector R21. Okay. Why is it R21? Why is it R21? Because the force F12, the force F12 is on 1 due to 2. Right? It is on 1 due to 2. Right? So the position vector will be of 1 with respect to 2. Okay? So I hope you are getting this thing, that why it is R21 over here. Just as in the previous case. Okay? So I'll be writing this unit vector R21 over here. Now this unit vector can be represented in this form, that is vector R21 divided by the modulus of that same vector. This thing. Okay? So this is the Coulomb's law when it is represented in the vector form. Okay? And I have shown you that what is vector R12? It is R1 minus R2. Similarly, what is vector R21? It is the position vector of point number 2 minus position vector of vector point number 1. Okay? So these are the things, these are the very important things. You can just note them down, not to understand them. Fine. So next we are into the superposition principle. Those of you, if you want to have some time, you can just note it down, understand it very carefully. Whenever we are trying to find the force, what we do, when we are trying to find the F12, force on 1 due to 2, okay? Then you have to use this position vector. Okay? And these are the magnitudes. Now you can actually also combine R21 square and this one R21. So it will become cube. Okay? So this one will become cube. So I can easily remove this thing. Okay? I can easily remove this part. And this thing will become cubic. In the denominator, this will become cubic, right? So what I will obtain actually over here is just this thing. Okay, I can easily say that this is now the exact vector representation of the force F12. Fine, this is the vector representation of the force F12. Okay. What it is, the unit vector r divided by the cube of this vector. Okay, this will not remain as the unit vector. Okay, this will not remain as the unit vector. It will become the vector itself. It will become the original vector. That is vector r. Okay, fine. So let's now come to the superposition principle. See, just now what we discussed was the two, we were just taking the two charges. Suppose we have n number of charges and we have to find the force on one particular charge. Suppose we are having this one particular charge Q1 and there are n number of charges Q2, Q3, Qn and there are n number of charges. Then what is the force, what will be the net force on this point charge Q1 due to the rest of these charges. That is the thing that we have to find out. Okay. What we have to find out? The net force on one particular charge due to the rest of the charges, whatever it is. Okay. And what we know? We know the relative position vectors. What is R12? What is R13? What is R1n? These are the relative position vectors. Okay. What is R13? It is the position vector of 1 minus 2. Okay. That is 1 minus R1 minus R2. Fine. And what are these F1 and F13 and what is F12? These are the forces, that is F12 is the force acting on 1 due to the charge 3. This F13, okay? Similarly, what is F12? It is the force acting on 1 on this point charge Q1 due to the charge Q2. So these are the forces, that is the F12, F13 and F1N. So we have the nth charge. So F1N is the force that is acting on one on point charge Q1 due to the charge Qn. Okay. So these are the, so we have to finally get the entire force. Okay. We will not be writing the entire thing. We have to actually write it in the vector form. What will be the net force in the vector form? That is the thing we will be studying in this superposition principle. So it is a very easy one. What we do over here is we simply write the individual forces, then we add them up. So just as we had seen in the previous case, in the case of the two charges, over here what we can do is, in order to find the force F12, okay, F12, what we are going to do is, the, we are going to use that formula that we just now saw, that is going to be K. See, when you are putting the values of Q1 and Q2, you will have to use the their signs also. Whether it is a, if it is a positive charge, let's say if it is a negative charge of minus 5 coulombs, then you have to put minus 5 coulombs. And if it is, and if Q2 is, let's say, 10 coulombs, then you will have to multiply minus 10, sorry, you will have to multiply 10 and minus 5. Okay? If Q1 is minus 5 coulombs and Q2 is 10 coulombs, then you have to multiply minus 5 into 10 and the answer will be minus 10. Okay? Q1 into Q2 will be minus 10. Right? So do not just use their magnitudes, you will have to use their signs as well. Okay? So this will become how much? This will become R21. And I'll have a cube of it over here and R21 vector over here. Similarly, what I'm going to do for the force on one due to the charge Q3, it is going to be K. Okay, so it is going to be what? KQ1 Q3 divided by R31. Okay, we all know what is R31. Right? R31. It is Q multiplied with this thing. Okay? So this is what we are going to do over here. Fine? Now we can also use the unit vector. We can also use the unit vector. Use their unit vectors as well. Okay? In order to eliminate these vectors, in order to eliminate the vectors R21 and R31, we can use their unit vectors also. Fine. So you can just simply write it down for the nth charge also, right? Like this one. KQ1 QN divided by RN1. It's Q. And we have R, vector R again. Okay. So this is how we can write down, we can just now simply add them up. Okay. You can just simply add them up and you can get the final vector. If you add up all of these, if you add up F12, F13, F1N, till F1N. Okay. It is still F1N. There will be F14, F15 and all of them. Right. So when you just simply add them up, what you are going to obtain is the net force F1. Just by getting their, what is this F1? F1 is nothing else but F12 plus F13 plus F14 till F1N. Okay, this is the net force that you are going to get that is acting on the charged Q1. Okay. So this is about the superposition principle. This is how you can get the net force that is going to act on the charge Q1 due to the different charges. Fine. So try to solve this question now. All of you just try to solve this question. If you want, you can go back to this one. You can just go back to this one. Okay. Okay, you can just have a look at that formula. Now you can solve this question. Just read out this question, you will be able to solve it. So this question, just read it out, that it says that in the given figure, Q1 and Q2 are the two positive charges. Q1 and Q2 are the two positive charges. At what position must a negative charge Q be placed so that the given system of charges is in equilibrium? Okay, that means the given system of charges, you want to keep them. The given system of charges will comprise of those three charges, okay? Q1, Q2 and Q. That will be your now the next new system, okay? So you want that the entire system should be in equilibrium. So try to solve it. At what position must a negative charge, okay? See, what we are going to do in this question is we are going to, if we know that the net force, okay, the net force that is going to act, we are going to just equate it to zero. So you'll have to just find the, see, if it is the equilibrium of the entire system, then that also means that the rest of the three charges, that is, suppose that you are placing the charge Q over here. Okay, suppose that you are placing the charge Q over here. Now my question to you guys is, does this line mean that the system, that the entire system is in equilibrium? Does this mean that the charge Q, okay, does it mean that is also in equilibrium? Can I say that the charge Q is also in equilibrium? Just give me your answer in the poll. From the question, can you say that the third charge Q is also in equilibrium, or any other charge Q1 or Q2? Can I say that each of the charges are in equilibrium? Can I say that each of the individual charges are actually in equilibrium? Okay. So 50-50. Okay friends, observe over here that yes, each of the charges are also going to be in equilibrium. Okay. Each of them are going to be in equilibrium. So you can just pick up anyone. You can just say that, okay, so you can say that this is, let's say that the point charge Q, the third one, I am placing it over here. Right. Then I can say that, okay, so then its position vector will be somewhat this thing. Its position vector is this. Right. I'm saying that its position vector is, let's say, vector r. I'm giving it a name as vector r. Fine. Now I'm going to write down the this particular force on the charge q due to the charge q1 and the charge q2. How I'm going to do it? Please note it down very carefully now. The net charge, the net electrostatic force on the charge q has to be equal to zero if the system, if I say that the entire system is in equilibrium. Fine. Because if the net force, or if the net force on this charge Q is not equal to zero, then it will just fly away. Okay. It is just going to accelerate. Okay. And it is going to have some motion. But if the system is in equilibrium, that means no part of it can be out of equilibrium. Fine. So we are going to get the forces. We are going to write down the net force on the charge Q due to the other two charges. So applying the Coulomb's law, we just apply the Coulomb's law. Then what you'll get is, I'm writing down over here. Okay, I'll just write it down in the whiteboard. Just write down in the whiteboard. I guess most of you would have drawn the diagram. Just observe the diagram. What is R1, what is R2, what is Q2, Q1, okay? And what is R and what is Q, right? Just observe the diagram. And then we are going to write it down. Just going to write it down over here. The net force on Q is, due to the charge Q2, it is going to be Q2 into vector R minus vector R2. Okay. Divided by vector R minus vector R2 magnitude Q. Okay, this is the force on Q due to the charge Q2. Okay, this is the force on Q, the negative charge Q, due to the charge Q2, okay? Plus the other one is Q1, Q, R minus R1. This is the relative position vector. and divided by the distance, that is this, this one. Okay. Is there any other force acting on the charge Q apart from the ones that I have mentioned over here? Tell me your answers. If you feel that there is another third force, there is another force, any other electrostatic force acting on the charge Q apart from the ones that I have mentioned, that I have already written over here, please give your answers. Okay. Also, okay, fine. So I get your answers as option 1. Okay, Kaustubh, Bhavya, Anand, Harmit. Okay, guys, observe over here that there is no other electrostatic force acting on this particular, on the third charge Q. Okay, it is these two charges only that are going to exert the two forces on the charge Q. Okay, that is F2F. That is on this one, that is the charge due to the charge Q1 and due to the charge Q2. There is no other third charge, okay? There is no other fourth charge that can exert force on this charge. So there will be only these two forces, the ones that I have written over here. Other force will be present, okay? So what we are going to do over here is, we are going to equate it to zero. This has to be equal to zero. Okay, because the net force acting on the charge Q is equal to zero. Fine. So when you just equate it to zero, what you will get is, you can easily remove out this Q. You can easily remove out this Q, and what you will be left is Q2 divided by R minus R2. Can I say this thing? That I will be left only with this thing, that is Q1 divided by R minus R1 square. Try to observe it as to why did I write this. See, observe that we had, that I converted one of, that I took one magnitude, that is R minus R2, and divided, it got divided with vector R minus R2, okay? And what I actually obtained was the unit vector, okay? I have just removed that unit vector, okay? Observe some of the other things that I am going to write down over here. Vector R minus vector R2 over here is, observe these unit vectors. Can you observe that this that I'm writing over here is a unit vector? Okay, this is a unit vector. Okay, so here what I can say is, see, these are just the mathematical calculations. What you have to just observe is that these are just the simple unit vectors. Okay, vector R minus vector R1. Fine. Actually, what you will finally get is this equation. You just keep solving these equations that I just gave you over there is, and what you will get is vector R. If you just solve out these equations, this is just the mathematical part now. Under root of Q2 vector R1 plus, try to get this final answer, try to do these calculations. Okay, these are just the mathematical conditions which you can do. Fine. Now similarly, if you have to get the equilibrium of the first force, sorry, if you have to get the equilibrium of the first charge Q1, if you want to find the equilibrium of the first charge Q1, then what you will get is this another, you will have to again write one more equation. You will have to again write an equation, that is, you will have to write the equation which involves the forces due to the other two charges. Okay, the equation will be somewhat like this one. क्यू इंटू वेक्टर आर माइनस आर वन डिवाइडेड बाय, आई एम नॉट गोइंग टू राइट द एंटायर इक्वेशन, यू कैन जस्ट अंडरस्टैंड इट फ्रॉम द सेम मैनर एज आई रोट द प्रीवियस वन. Okay, this thing plus q2 into vector r1 minus r2 divided by vector r1 minus r2. This will be equated to 0. Okay. Now this, you can also multiply the k and the q1. Okay, you can also multiply the k and the q1 part. Those are the constants and they will actually get cancelled out from both the sides. Okay, so I did not wrote them over here. The k and the q1 will get cancelled out because I'm going to equate it to 0. Fine. So finally, what I will get is when you just put the values of the vector r, what you will get is this thing. Or if you just try to get this value of q from this equation by removing this k and q1. K and q1, if you just remove it, okay, then what you will get is minus of q2 divided by vector r1 minus r2 square multiplied by r minus r1. Square, okay, this thing you will be obtaining as q. Okay. Now, in this equation, if you substitute the value of vector r that you have obtained over here, if you substitute this particular value, then do this mathematical thing. Okay, you can just substitute the value. I will be giving you the final answer. You can just note it down. The final answer will be, The final answer will be q is actually equal to minus of q1, q2 divided by under root of q1 plus q2. Okay, this will be your final answer. You can observe that q1 and q2 are the positive quantities, and so how this is coming out to be a negative quantity, which we had assumed that the q is a negative charge. Okay, can you all observe in this? You can all observe, read the question, that q is a negative charge, right? So we have just equated the forces, the net forces on q and q1 equal to 0. Fine. And we had this variable r, we just replaced this variable with the known quantities, that is q1, q2 and r2 and q. And then we got the answer, okay? So this was about the superposition principle. This was just an example on the superposition principle. The next is the shell theorem. Try to understand. See, there are actually two things in this shell theorem. What is the shell? Shell is something like your plastic cricket ball. Okay. This is not hollow. It is not hollow from inside. Okay. It is actually hollow. Okay. It is actually hollow. There is space. There is empty space inside this particular sphere. Okay. It is not completely packed up. Okay. So it has some inner radius as well as some outer radius. What is the inner radius? This is the inner radius. This red line is showing you the inner radius. There is nothing present inside the body over here. Okay. The material of the body is present only at this point. Only at between the inner radius and the outer radius. The matter is present only between the inner radius and the outer radius. The outer radius is shown in the green line. Okay. So you can observe over here that the material is present only at this position. Fine. So this is the shell. The theorem for this type of a shell is that we can see, suppose we have any particular charge over here. Okay. Then for this charge, this entire shell will actually behave like a point object that is placed at the center of this shell. Okay. You can assume this is the shell theorem. What is this? It says that for this point charge that is placed outside this shell will behave like a point charge placed at the center of the shell. Okay, I'll just read it out that the uniform spherical shell of charge behaves for external points as if its charge were concentrated at its center. This is the center. Okay, and what will be the charge on this center point? It will be the charge. It will remain the same charge that was on the shell itself. Right. So two things are there. We can assume that for any point outside this shell, we can assume that the net charge is actually concentrated at the center of this shell, for this shell. Okay. And what is that quantity of that net charge? It remains the same. Whatever was the charge present on this shell will be the point charge that we can assume over here. That is Q and Q. Okay. So you can just use this particular equation. You can use this particular Coulomb's law for this shell also. Okay. Okay. Another very important thing is that suppose you have any point inside the shell. Okay. This was about the point outside the shell. Now suppose you have any point inside the shell and it is having some charge Q2. Okay. Then another important theorem, the next part of the theorem is that this shell is, now forget about this Q1. Okay. Now forget about this Q1. This was about the external point. Now we are talking about a point that is internal to this shell. The point is that there is the shell which is having a charge Q. It is not going to exert any force on this point charge Q2 which is lying inside the shell. This is the second theorem for this part. Okay. A uniform spherical shell of charge exerts no force on a charged particle inside the shell. This is the second part of the theorem. Okay. So the force for on the point Q2 exerted by the shell having a charge Q is, tell me the answer. Is it this thing? That is the A option is this thing, or the, and your B option is zero. Okay. So tell me what is the correct answer. I'm posting a poll. Yes, give your answers. What is the force on the charge Q2? Okay. Is it F is equals to this one? Or you can just say that it is, okay, you can just give that this force is also Q1. You can just say that, I'll just change the question. You can just give it as Q1, okay? You can say that it is also Q1. Just forget this Q1. Forget this outer point Q1, okay? Fine? Yes, all of you are correct. All of you are correct. Most of you are correct. Just a few, two of you. Two of you are not able to get it, okay? Okay, who is it? Niladri and Achana. Okay. Niladri and Achana. Fine. So observe over here that the force on Q1, on this Q1, due to this shell is going to be definitely, it is going to be zero. Okay. It is definitely going to be zero. It is not going to be the one that is mentioned over here. Okay. This is the property of the shell because it is spherical in shape. Okay. So the net force, what actually happens is that there are small charges present inside in the entire surface of this particular shell, right? And all of those forces will actually get cancelled out. When you try to find out what will be the force due to this particular region and due to this particular region, and when you just integrate them, then the net force acting on this point, on this charge, due to these, all of these small parts of the shell will actually cancel out the net force acting on this particular charge Q1. And hence it becomes zero. This is the point. Okay. So you have two things now. Okay. So you have two things now. That is, for any point, I just repeat it out. All of you just concentrate over here now. For any point that is lying outside the shell, this one Q1, the force is this thing. F is equals to K Q1 Q upon R square. Okay. And for any point that is actually lying inside the shell over here, the force on it is going to be equal to zero. These are the two very important things. Okay. So guys, I hope you have all understood what we studied in the Coulomb's law. What exactly is the Coulomb's law? How we represent it in the vector form. Okay. And where is this Coulomb's law valid and this important theorem, that is the shell theorem. Fine. So at the end, I'll just give you one question. I'll just leave you with one question. Try to find the answer for it. Try to solve this question. It is over here in the next one. Read out this question. We'll have to solve this question. I'll give you the final answer, okay? Try to solve this question. Circular loop of radius r, which is made up of an insulating string, is uniformly charged by a charge q. Okay? Circular loop of radius r. Read this question very slowly. Try to understand what is mentioned over here. Calculate the tension in the string when a point charge q naught is placed at the center of the loop. Okay? So suppose that this is your loop. Suppose that this is your loop. Or over here. Okay, and you place a point charge q naught at its center. You're going to place a point charge q naught at its center. What you have to find is the tension on the string when a point charge q naught is placed at the center of this loop. The loop is of radius r. Okay? Insulating string. And the loop is having a charge that is q. It is having a charge q. So you have to find the tension in the string. Okay? So I'm giving you the final answer. Try to get it. Tension is equals to q naught divided by 8 pi square epsilon naught r square. See guys, why I'm leaving you with this question is that because it is important to solve some questions. Okay? You need to start practicing with some of these types of questions. I've given you the answer. Try to solve it. Try to get this answer. Okay, you'll also have to practice a lot. You need to practice some very good number of questions. And it is not always that I'll be solving all of these questions and you just note them down. Okay, so that thing is not going to happen. Sometimes I'm just going to give you some questions and most of the time I'm going to solve the questions in the class itself. So this is just a homework for you guys. Take this question as a homework. Okay. So, see you soon in the next class. All of you just watch the recording. Just watch the recording in case you have missed out anything. And thank you everyone. Take care and bye bye. Okay.